Hi, my name is Thayer Long.
And I'm Elizabeth Colleton.
And we're here today to talk to you about picking and choosing plants wisely for your garden. Elizabeth and I have been working on a program for the Master Gardeners of Northern Virginia that talks about climate conscious gardening. And today we're specifically going to be talking about how you can choose plants wisely for your garden. You know, Elizabeth, a lot of people are looking for certain looks, they're looking for certain types of plants. They tend to gravitate a lot towards non-natives. But I think what we do as master gardeners, and certainly what we do here at the community garden, is show really viable alternatives, native alternatives to what people want to do on a non-native species. So what do we have here at the Glen Carlin Garden that people would find interesting?
Right, so one of the things, we're gonna show you some vines today, because vines can, cover a multitude of sins if you have a fence that you're not wild about looking at, if you want a little bit extra privacy. We have some examples here today that can really help you think of something that's, a native alternative to some of the non-native vines that can really pose problems. They do tend to strangle trees, they do tend to climb buildings and, do damage to your right. Your bricks and mortar. So we have a few examples here today, starting with an American Wisteria. And it is a, you can see it has almost the same habit, but it's not quite as aggressive as the Japanese Wisteria that can really, you've seen it, crossing telephone wires.
Right,
and trees.
Beautiful, but can be very, invasive.
Yeah,
right.
So that's an alternative, and a lot of people don't know that an American Wisteria exists as an alternative. Along the fence line here is a really interesting thing. It's actually a semi-evergreen vine called crossvine. And it has beautiful flowers in the springtime, and because of our changing climate, it does tend to hang around throughout the winter, providing some level of privacy
So this is an evergreen. So it's an evergreen, right?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. And so this is called crossvine, and again, you can see it still sort of takes over, but it's a native species. And then finally, at the end of the fence line here, a lot of gardeners will be familiar with the Japanese honeysuckle, which just is really hard to control. We have an American honeysuckle here, which has some beautiful yellow flowers in the springtime. And again, the idea here is that all of these plants are native and support the pollinators that we want to attract to our gardens. So Thayer, here we are in the demonstration garden at Glen Carlin, and I see, in late summer that we are in full bloom with the Jopie weed and the goldenrod. What do you see here as a master gardener that supports the idea of growing plants to support pollinators, butterflies, moths, bees, even birds?
So I think the benefit of planting natives, particularly thinking about the climate, is the fact that native plants are specifically tailored to meet the nutritional needs of the native insect and butterfly and just animal population. So they sort of go together. So by choosing native, you're helping out the native species that live off the plants, as well as just the other benefits that I think we've all talked about just growing native and how they're most adaptable to the existing climate.
Right. I mean, in a time when we've seen a lot of habitat loss and a lot of use of plants in a garden that really don't offer a lot of ecological benefit, if gardeners can pull back and try to plant these plants that are, this is their home, this is they've co-evolved with the birds and the bees, and you're going to have a richer, more complex garden ecology.
And one other point too, just around, because we're standing in front of it, the goldenrod.
Yeah.
So not all native species are equal, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
Some are called keystone plants. Goldenrod is one keystone plant. It can support dozens and dozens and dozens of native insects and butterflies.
Mm-hmm.
So also, I think it's important that people listening sort of take that into account as well when they're looking at the plant selection.
Yeah, that's a great point. And then finally, I think, these are the types of plants that are you know, drought resistant. They don't require that much watering, am I right?
Correct.
Yeah, so these are the types of things that are, you know, once they're established in your garden, they're really gonna take care of themselves growing season after growing season. So Thayer, here we are in the patio area of the garden, and I see that we've got some native and non-native plants in pots. What's going on here?
Well, I think there's a couple things that this illustrates. You know, first, you know, if you do have an aggressive native, which does not mean it's invasive, it's just an aggressive native, and you still want to enjoy it, you know, you can put it in a pot. We've done that with mints. We've got some obedient plant, you know, another, you know, Virginia mountain mint here. I have these in my garden, and I can tell you they do spread.
Yep.
So if you want to enjoy it, but, you know, want to limit its growth, consider a pot. And I think certainly this also speaks to if you have a small garden, a patio, you can still enjoy a balcony. You can still enjoy by looking at it. So I think that's what we're showing, definitely showing
here.
You're
still able to attract the pollinators to your garden,
correct,
but maybe on a smaller scale, and it's not going to take over.
And it's not going to, exactly right.
Yeah.
And what we have here is, you know, we're all very familiar with Pachysandra. Mm-hmm. I had a Pachysandra in my lawn.
Yep.
I like Pachysandra. And I know we talk a lot about natives as master gardeners. You know, not having a garden all 100% native is not evil. It's not the worst thing. We still like to enjoy some non-native stuff. So here you've got Pachysandra, but in order to enjoy it, but again, limit it so it's not invasive, we put it in a pot.
Right. You still get the visual interest. You still get the texture maybe that you're looking at, but you're not going to let it spread.
Correct.
And take over. And in a minute, we can go look at actually an alternative native alternative to Pachysandra, which is the Allegheny spurge.
That's great. That's great. Elizabeth, we're in the area of the Glen Carlin Garden, a little bit shaded here. We're standing or squatting in front of a really lovely bed here. What can we learn about this and about how to choose plants wisely?
Right. So here's a great example. This is a pretty newly established shade garden just this summer, actually. And the idea here is to choose plants that, again, once they are sort of firmly established, they are going to help us break that cycle of watering excessively, having to fertilize and put down herbicides that sort of tie into that whole climate change cycle of having to use fossil fuel based products. And the way we have accomplished that is we have, you know, started out doing some drip irrigation to get everything started, but we have selected plants that are native alternatives to things that we, you know, typically use. Uh-huh. We talked about the Pachysandra back in the pot.
Right.
Here's the Allegheny spurge, which is a nice alternative to a Pachysandra. You can see a deep green foliage, which is really pretty, and it's quite a sturdy plant. We've got a selection of sedges circling this dogwood tree. We've got some marginal dry ferns. And some native loosestrife. And, you know, in a year to 2 years, all of this is going to accomplish the goal that we talked about earlier, which is shading the soil, cooling things down, having gardens fulfill that function of, you know, kind of lowering the overall temperature, stopping erosion, and, you know, sort of reducing inputs overall so that you are, really gardening sustainably.
Right. So, Elizabeth, there's a lot to learn. There's a lot to know about plants, about what, you know, what their impact is, what their benefit is. But hopefully we've given everyone a good taste on things that they should consider when picking, choosing, selecting plants for their garden.
Right. And, of course, we have so many options here to look at the Glen Carlin demonstration garden. The important thing to know, I think, is that regardless of your particular planting conditions, there is a native plant there for you that's going to work for you, that's going to, accomplish that goal of sort of reducing inputs like chemicals and a lot of water, and to really take advantage of what native plants offer, which is, you know, they're pretty drought resistant. They're acclimated to our particular region. Once they get established, they're going to do just fine. So yeah, I think it's a really positive trend in gardening. And if you want to learn more, you can check out our website at mgnv.org. Happy gardening.